sizin başını yıkıyorum. You started this magic that matter, and you saw that the Yadel is that that matter seems to have the same energy density as the baryons in our universe, and the idea of part of the motivation is to kind of explore some mechanism that generates both baryon and baryon density at the same time. And the basic idea has been kind of summarized last time, the first generating the asymmetry. You generate the asymmetry, generate the asymmetry in one sector or the other. So we have two sectors that we are imagining. Drawing this a lot. So you generate it here, or you generate it there, or you generate it together. And some processes will transfer the asymmetry from one sector to the other. The second stage will decouple the two sectors. Make sure that these asymmetries are not pushed out. And the last stage, one has to make sure that the symmetric component of dark matter is washed out. So wash out the symmetric component. For me, there's the symmetric component. They couple sufficiently strongly to make in certain thermal equilibrium. In that case, you have a thermal abundance of dark matter. And you know that if you from the negative away, then you remain left over with too much dark matter, which is symmetric. You want to get rid of that. But there's another thing. You see, when we talk about the ethnogenesis case as an example, you will see that. It is very often that you expect the symmetric component to dominate, even if you produce it through some heavy decay or some heavy field out of equilibrium decay. And the reason is that you are trying to be dominated by some asymmetric component. To generate an asymmetry, we discussed it yesterday, you need to know about cyclic violation. So, cyclic violation, so let's postpone it. I'm going to get back to it in 10 minutes. But what I wanted to say is that there's an argument of why we think that the symmetric component usually would dominate over the asymmetric component. And if you really want to explain this asymmetry by having two asymmetries in both sectors, you have to get rid of the symmetric component. But I'll mention it again. Okay, so let's discuss these two components of coming up with the right abundance. Okay, so steps 1 and 2. All right, so I'm going to give you two examples. There are many. The literature is filled with all kinds of models. Let me just give you two examples to give you the idea. So we said that there are basically two mechanisms. One is cogenesis, when you generate both the asymmetries at the same time with the same mechanism. Or you can have a transfer mechanism. You generate it in one and you transfer it to the other. Okay, so let's start with some transfer, and we're going to go
with some perturbative transfer.
Okay, so we want to write down some perturbative interaction that couples in 2 seconds. And in order, so let's imagine that we are generating the asymmetry here in the visible sector. By generating the asymmetry, what we mean is that we generate some B minus L asymmetry. Okay, so we generate some B minus L asymmetry in standard model. Now we need to couple the dark matter to some operator that knows about B minus L, some operator that is charged under B minus L. And we will couple it in such a way that it will decouple later on. So what are the B minus L operators that we can have? So, okay, so let's say that. So we will use non-normalizable interactions. Because these are weak or small, and therefore at low temperature. So they're going to be separated by some mass scale M, and at the temperature much higher than M, these interactions are fast. And the temperature much lower than M, these interactions are small because they are highly suppressed, and therefore they are slow and decoupled from the transfer mechanism is coming. Okay. So what kind of operators can we have?
Well,
what kind of operators do we have in the standard model that are B minus L? Has to be gauge invariant, has to mobilize a class operator. One example is UDT, okay? The UDT operator is one example that knows about B minus L. We would have Q and B bar. There's another one, L and E. These are right-handed fermions, and these are left-handed ones. And there's also HUL. Maybe David will tell you about in the MSSM about the R-parity operators. And these are the type of operators you have to worry about, and pray in particular also with B minus L. So, anyway, so the operator we want to write down, the Lagrangian we want to write down, is some operator in the dark matter sector, times this operator that knows about B minus L, divided by some M to the right mass scale, so that it has the right dimension. For instance, we can have some X times the UDB over M squared. Okay? Okay, so this is our fermion, the dark matter fermion. And it couples to the quarks. And now, Kai has to know about variant dilation. We generate the asymmetry here, and we try to translate it for this operator. So we have all kinds of interaction. For instance, Kai and U bar. Go back and forth to the D bar, and so on, okay, and go back and forth to the D, and so on. And the rough rate, so what is the temperature that we need? So very, very roughly, just back to the envelope. Are there other questions? So just back of the envelope, an estimate of what is the energy that what temperature will dominate? So the rate as usual, goes like 1 over n to the 4th, this decoupling to the 4th, and we just supplement it with temperature, and we just do dimensional analysis. We do all that to be smaller, so that it decouples from the rate of expansion. So smaller than 8, which is what we're already planned. So very, very roughly, so T decoupling is what? Is M times M over M plan to the 1/3. Okay? So the temperature drops somewhere below M times this factor, this decoupling, but when of course the temperature is very high, when the temperature is above the mass scale, of course we are not allowed even to write this operator, therefore the fit theory breaks down. What we really need to do is to take into account this M, but what we are guaranteed is that these kind of couplings are now in thermal equilibrium, they are pretty fast, and therefore the transfer of the so how do we calculate the a solution? Actually, it's not very difficult. What we want to do, let me remind you, so how to calculate. Symmetry. So let me remind you that the number density, I'm sorry, the equality time before, is g over 2 pi q integral, and this would be f of t, is a g over 2 pi q times the omega and the square root of e squared minus m squared. Right? So when we take f, it could be 1 over e to the e minus mu over e plus or minus 1. So this is the number density of a particle. We want to calculate m chi minus m chi bar. So we need to know the chemical potential of chi and the chemical potential of chi bar. So what is the relation between the chemical potential of chi and chemical potential of chi bar? So when is this true? When will the chemical potential be related with such? Okay, so if we have a particle that interact fast, they go into chemical equilibrium. So have you guys seen the idea, heard about the idea of chemical equilibrium? So they go into chemical equilibrium. So for instance, if chi and chi bar say can annihilate into photons, particles and antiparticles, or some kind of additional particles, and if this interaction is sufficiently fast, then this interaction implies that there's chemical equilibrium between the chi and chi bar and the photon. Of course, photons have zero chemical potential, and therefore mu chi plus mu chi bar is equal to zero, which implies that mu chi equals minus mu chi bar. Okay? So if there is some interaction that choose that occurs fast, then we are guaranteed to have this, so let's assume it. And so what we have here is just g over 2 pi cubed times, well, could be only g over 2 pi, so we need to talk about that. And then
this problem is h cross times e times 1 over e to the e minus mu chi over t plus minus 1 minus the same thing, but with e plus mu chi over t plus mu.
So this is an integral one can solve.
So if you do this integral and follow it, you find that for high temperature, this just equals the following, this is finding u over t. This is much larger than n. And otherwise, it is this. And the hyperbolic sine is of u over t. Times e to the minus n. Okay, this is for t, much more than
t. It's very, very similar. We already have seen this t cube term, and we have already seen this expression. But what we see is that if we know what is the chemical potential due to these interactions, so if we can solve for the chemical potential due to these interactions, we will know what is the asymmetry that we generated in that sector. So all we have left to do is to solve the equation, extract the chemical potential, and this will tell us what is the asymmetry. Okay? That's what we're after. Okay, so how do we solve for the chemical potential? Well, there's a long list of interactions that occur at a given temperature in the early universe. Are there any questions, by the way? So there's a long list of interactions to compute. We have, say, interactions like W turning into U left and a D left, U bar left and a D left, or the heat that turns into a U bar left, U right, and all kind of, and each one of those imply some U left, U right, and this one will imply U H plus U left, U right. And so we have a list, there's a long list of interactions just coming from the standard model. I'm not going to use the model. There are also, there's also an equation that arises from the spiral interaction. This looks something like this. U left of U to D left. That's the sum of mu and 0 phylons, and there's charge conservation of the phylons. This is charge conservation. So for instance, Q of electromagnetism imply 2 times 3 times mu u left plus mu u right plus 3 of u d left plus u d right minus the sum of u I left plus u I right for u w is 2 u h equal 0. Okay, so that, and same thing you have for q to d
you have something like a 9 over 2, some u unit minus u dx, half of the u y minus u I L. Sorry, this is actually 2, this is not that easy. Minus 4 u w minus u h plus mu h minus. And that is true again, as it is true, if you never make them broken. So I'm listing these equations, but they're not really important. You can find them in the literature, they're easy to write. We have a set of equations that follow from the interaction and the conservation laws. And all you need to do is now add another equation. So what is the equation that we need to add? So if we have this interaction through u bar, d bar, d bar, what is the equation that we need to add? On these are right hand things. So this implies a fast interaction. We're assuming that these are fast interactions between these particles. So the sum of the chemical potential is zero. So it's u current minus u right minus 2 u d right equals zero. We have one more equation. We solve all these equations and remember that they are temperature dependent because some of these interactions go in or out of equilibrium depending on the temperature. You follow the evolution, you get the final abundance that you're interested in. Okay. So it's just a simple set of linear equations that you need to solve. And so what the final answer is in this specific case is if you do that,
yes.
Yes. The So we need to get this relation that we expected from the very beginning, that the mass of the proton and the mass of dark matter are related. And there is this really factor of 5. Okay. Any questions? Okay. So
this to get the Rayleigh abundance?
I'm sorry?
This to get the right Rayleigh abundance?
Yeah. So, I mean, the mass you extract, you mean this? You extract by demanding that you're going to get the right Rayleigh abundance. So this will tell you the number density. We already saw how we calculate the number density using this chemical potential. And if we have the number density, then the mass follows because mass and number density are the energy density or mass density of these particles. Okay, so that's a nice prediction. That's a nice model that gives an interesting prediction. As I mentioned before, there are other models that give some different predictions. But let's see a different mechanism now. Instead of this transfer, let's discuss a different mechanism of cogenesis. Okay? So, we need a mechanism that generates both the asymmetry in the visible sector and in the dark sector at the same time. There are several of those that I mentioned with electric baryogenesis. There are these dodaphic diamonds, there are leptogenesis. So, let's just discuss leptogenesis because I find them more attractive for one reason. Okay, so how are the three Sakharov conditions that we discussed yesterday fulfilled in leptogenesis? Okay, well, step back. What is leptogenesis? So,
Leptogenesis. The idea behind leptogenesis is that you have you add right-handed neutrinos, that couple to the lepton of the Higgs. So you have an interaction of the four lambda times M and H. And this right-handed neutrino decays when at the early universe below at out of equilibrium when the temperature drops below its mass, and when it decays, it transfers its lepton number onto this. But because it couples in a way which is CP violating, it transfers, it generates an asymmetry, it decays more into the particles, the lepton versus the anti-lepton, for instance, and therefore it generates an asymmetry. Okay? So that's the picture. You remember that we discussed briefly yesterday the picture of electron paragenesis, and we saw how the Sakharov conditions must be fulfilled. And here again, all the Sakharov conditions are fulfilled. So there's a whole huge literature on leptogenesis, by the way. It's a very interesting subject. I'm not going to go through it because it takes too long. But so just to mention, this is a free Sakharov condition. So we say one when it's C and CP violation, and that's just for the couplings to the leptons. We said that we need the B violation, and really here what we have is lepton number violation. So I'll write down for the one more term in this Lagrangian, I'll write it down now, which is n times the mass times the very roughly times the right of the neutrinos. And these are Majorana masses. We give Majorana masses to the right of the neutrinos, which imply that this together with this breaks lepton number. Okay, so if you want this term to preserve lepton number, then n has to be charged, say, 1. But this term breaks it because it's a Majorana mass, it's an n squared, which implies that n cannot carry any charges. Its antiparticle is equal to its particle, and therefore it's the same as its particle. And therefore, this together with this breaks lepton number, and hence you get lepton number violation, which is later, using the Sphalerons, translates into baryon number violation. Okay. So this occurs for the Majorana nature, Majorana mass, of the Majorana nature of the right of the neutrinos. And the third condition, the departure from thermal equilibrium, just occurs because the decays occur at when T, a temperature equal to the mass of the right hand neutrino, smaller than the Hubble rate. So these decays occur out of equilibrium, and therefore there's departure from thermal equilibrium during these decays. Okay? So you want to write down a little bit more precisely, then let me call it y alpha, y alpha, and this is mi. Okay, so I've added several, say three generations of right of neutrinos. The reason this model is somewhat motivated is because of the Cecil mechanism. We already know that the neutrinos have masses. Again, I'm not going into that, but we already know that the neutrinos have masses.
And when you integrate out the mass of the white neutrinos, you get this is a cycle mark that right and neutrinos are motivated by neutrino masses. And that's just because that when you integrate them out, they generate masses to the right, to the left of the neutrinos of the form. When you integrate it out, you get an operator in the standard order, which goes like mh squared over m. M is the mass of the right of the neutrinos. And because the Higgs gets a verb, this implies that m nu is of order nu squared over m. That's the CISO mechanism that just follows from the mass matrix, where the left-handed neutrinos and the right-handed neutrinos. So the left-handed neutrinos don't have mass in the standard model. These have a coupling of order YV, and these have masses of order M. And what you see is that because this is assumed to be much larger than V, we get these masses which are very small. It's suppressed by V and our order V squared over M. And if V is 100 GeV, this needs to be around, because you cover the order 1, this needs to be around 10 to the 14 GeV. So this gives you a scale which naturally generates the right size of the mass of the neutrino. So again, I'm rushing through this, I don't know what you're trying to say, but this is a motivation, a strong motivation for why we think there might be right of neutrinos. And then the idea of autogenesis is that it comes along with this mechanism to generate the asymmetry. Okay? So that's just a side remark. And yeah. There are very good reviews for leptogenesis. Encourage you to read them, they're very interesting. Okay, so if I have this Lagrangian, how do we generate the asymmetry? Is this, so suppose I just have an M that decays into a lepton in the Higgs. Is this alone enough to generate an asymmetry? This diagram alone, the tree level diagram that allows the M to decay to a lepton in the Higgs, enough to generate an asymmetry? What do we need to generate the asymmetry? We need CP violation. And CP violation, so everyone has learned about CP violation already, or is that just in a few hours? Who has learned about CP violation in the standard model? Okay. So you know that the couplings must be imaginary, must have an imaginary part in order for CP violation to be broken. So if all the couplings are real, CP violation is not, CP is not violated. And therefore we need to know about CP violation. If this was the only diagram, if we only take into account this diagram, because the rate of decay is proportional to the coupling squared, we would not see any phases, and therefore this diagram would not tell us about CP violation, hence we cannot produce any asymmetry. So we really need to take into account additional higher order decays in order to know about CP violation and hence produce an asymmetry. So there are two relevant diagrams. This is N1. In the case for LMH, and there is another one of the diagram, which is this. This is N, L, H, N, H, L. Okay. So this is the one order that we have to take into account.
And when we sum this and square it, that's how we're going to see CP violations for the interference between this one loop contribution to the tree level contribution. And here comes your question again about why do we think that the symmetric component dominates? Well, the symmetric component doesn't need to know about CP violation. So in this cogenesis example, you have tree level decay, which completely dominates, that produce the lepton, and later on they'll also produce dark matter. But in order to see asymmetry, and asymmetry you have to take into account the one loop contribution and tell you that no about CP violation. And these are suppressed compared to the tree level ones. So now we're talking about lepton, soon we'll talk about dark matter, but it's the same picture. You have the K, which is completely dominated, the symmetric component is completely dominated of the asymmetric component. But of course, we only care about the asymmetric one, the symmetric one disappears for annihilation. Okay? So, okay, so these are the diagrams that you need to take into account. And what, and it's very easy to extend this into two sector leptogenesis. So the picture is the following. We have these ends, okay. We have these ends that decay into the standard model. So this Y, N, L, H, and they can also decay into the dark matter, which I'm going to do on chi, so if they decay through some lambda N chi value. Okay. We have two different sectors, one of them is going to be a scalar here too, two different sectors, the right energy unit, and they can produce the dark matter, they can also produce the electrons. Okay. So the question, by the way, you notice that I wrote that we need more than a single end. Why is that? Can we write a model like that where there's just a single end? N1 that decays into the lepton in the visible sector and the dark matter in the hidden sector. Is that good enough? Yes. Yeah, the answer is no. Okay, so just because we can redefine the couplings, by redefining the N, we can redefine the couplings to make them real. If they are real, there's no CP violation, because no CP violation, again, we don't see any asymmetry. So we need to have at least two Ns, N1 and N2, in order to produce the asymmetry. That's also true for production of the correct mass spectrum for the neutrinos. So that's all consistent. We should have at least two right and the neutrinos. So we want to write the, so we write this toy model now. And it's just a toy model to demonstrate. So we have this mi n squared, mi squared, plus y, I, n, I, I'm going to draw indices for the same indices, important here, plus lambda I, n I times. Okay? And we're going to define epsilon for CP. Epsilon CP is the small parameter that tells us how much asymmetry you generate. This is the rate for the k of n to chi phi minus the rate of the k to chi bar phi dagger divided by the sum, well, divided by the gamma in total. And the same thing we can define for the leptons, is gamma L going to chi phi, sorry, to LH, minus gamma L going to the L value, L bar H double, minus gamma. Okay. And several effects that can happen. And we won't go through them, but in principle, once the end decays, you can. So, first, then, in the decay of the end, if we have some thermal distribution of ends, so what is the phi y of the delta chi? The y of the delta chi is just, you know, it will be proportional to the y equilibrium of n. Okay? But it's going to be suppressed because of the CP variation, because this is not a large number. This is completely calculated by this diagram that I mentioned before. We write out the diagrams, we compute them, we plug it into the brakes, and we have the answer. It's going to be proportional to the phases of these couplings. So I'll tell you the answer in a second. So it's going to be suppressed by some epsilon. But it's also going to be suppressed by the inefficiency, so-called washout effect and transfer effect, the inefficiency of having these asymmetries being washed out, because we have because these interactions can be sufficiently fast to erase some of the asymmetries that we produce. So in the case, but then chi can transfer into chi bar through these additional n interactions, through the interaction on the right of the neutrino. So there is some parameter we call eta, and that encodes the information about the inefficiencies of producing this asymmetry, namely the washout effect and transfer effect during this process. Okay? And we can compute it. So one finds that this is the answer. Such that y1 is just real and y2 is y2 e to the I phi l, and the same thing with chi, which shows lambda 1 to be real and lambda 2 to be lambda 2 e to the I phi. Okay? So these are the phases, and we have this in the phases, but the phases are 0, there's no CP violation. This R, if we take y1 equals y2, all that is written here is that this is proportional to the rate of n1 that came into n and h. And this is the rate of n that came into phi and chi. And therefore, what you see here is just the ratio of branching fractions. Because this is proportional to this ratio, you can get any number density in this versus this. So the result is not surprising. You have this right-hand neutrino, the right-hand neutrino can decay into two sectors. And now, how many of the decays occur into the star model versus how many decays occur into the dark matter simply depend on the branching fraction of n into this sector versus this sector. So if for some reason this coupling is larger than this, because the branching fraction goes like the coupling squared, then what you get is that you're generating much more of one sector versus the other, and therefore the prediction for the mass just goes away. The mass can be anything, if the number density can be anything, the ratio of number densities can be anything, so can the mass, okay? Because the relation between the number densities is the same, is opposite compared to the ratio between the masses. So is this for the sphere? So again, the conclusion is, so the conclusion is that the asymmetry, the relation between the asymmetries depends strongly on the branching fraction, on the BR of n to dark matter sector versus BR of n to a standard model sector, and therefore n chi over n proton can vary accordingly. Yes? the asymmetry, the number densities can vary, then of course the masses vary in the same way. And therefore we have no prediction. It could be anywhere between, say, kV to 100 TV. kV just is a low limit because below kV the free streaming is too, the dark matter is too hot. We'll talk about free streaming. And when the dark matter mass is too high, then you cannot annihilate the symmetric component away, and so you will close the universe. So there are limits unrelated to this discussion, but bottom line is that there is no prediction for this asymmetric scenario. And again, precisely because to generate the asymmetry, we need to know about CP violation. If you don't assume that there is annihilating away the symmetric component, you're going to find that the symmetric component is completely over-dominated. Okay, the last step of asymmetric dark matter, let's just discuss briefly how we annihilate away the symmetric component. What is the demand for the cross section? So, step three. So as we said, the symmetric component is subdominant. The asymmetric component is subdominant, and we need to annihilate it away. We need to annihilate away the symmetric component either by having some heavy field like that, or we can do a T-channel annihilation. But whatever we do, if we have a heavy field, we have to go through an S-channel, where this is off-shell. If we have a light field, lighter than Kaiser, we can just annihilate it through T-channel. And whatever we do, we need to compute the relic abundance of the symmetric component. So for that, we need to write down the right equation.
Sorry, is it always true that the symmetric component is dominant at the beginning?
I said that very often it is dominant for two different reasons. So if we're talking about the transfer, then you know that the two sectors have to communicate high temperature. If they communicate, typically they could equilibrate, and therefore you would have a thermal distribution of dark matter, chi plus chi bar. Thermal distribution is large unless you annihilate it, just like Weems. Unless you annihilate them away, you're going to get too many of them, and therefore you need to write if the cross section is zero, you just get rid of it quickly, and therefore you have to get rid of it.
But it depends on the cross-section. It could be that cross-section is small enough.
So the conclusion of what we're going to do is that we need a cross-section of larger than 3 times 10 to the minus 26. So if you have a thermal distribution, you need to get rid of this thermal distribution. 3 times 10 to the minus 26 centimeters cubed per second give you the right abundance. If you don't want it to dominate, you need to make the cross-section to be even larger. So that's going to be the conclusion from what we're going to do next. But that's only if you have some thermal abundance. In this case, or some non-number equilibrium decay, in that case, in the cogenesis case, you actually often generate a symmetric component much larger, much more than you generate the asymmetric component simply because of the degradation. So, alright. So, so what we care about is the value, if you want, of the following value, the asymmetry between the density of the anti-dark matter compared to the density of matter. Okay, and it's very easy to write down omega chi bar is just R infinity over 1 minus R infinity times eta chi eta s naught over
Dorsi, and on the car is one, and one are infinity, and the other one, and car is not on the Dorsi. Or at the car, with the variable, which is n car minus n car bar, over n dumb, or s or n dumb. Okay? So what is the Boltzmann equation? What is the Boltzmann equation that allows the annihilation of a Kallis and Bar? So let me give to you what Kallis say. That's 3h and Kallis equal what? By now we know it.
Sorry, what is R?
R is this. Yeah, it's just the relic asymmetry. It's the leftover of the asymmetry, namely how much anti dark matter do we have compared to the dark matter. Just a change of variables, it's nothing very good. And lambda has the cross section, and lambda has the mass of the dark matter. Okay, but that's the quantity that we care about. And if you, when z goes to infinity, if we go into very late times, the equilibrium value of course goes to zero, the equilibrium value goes like e to the minus z, right? It's on that, therefore this goes to zero, and we get that the r over r is something, and hence it's just r at late z, it's just r it freezes out times some exponential factor. Pretty simple. So if we draw, if you try to solve this, what you would find is that usually we have the equilibrium value. If we have eta equals zero, no asymmetry, then of course R, the ratio between the anti-matter versus matter is just constant, because there's no asymmetry, and if it started one, it will remain one. But so we have the usual usual decoupling if eta equals zero. And if we take eta different than zero, then we will have a little bit more of chi and a little bit less of chi bar. So these are the lines of eta different than zero. And this is what you get when you try to solve this equation. Okay? And bottom line, we need a cross section, not to dominate, we need a cross section even larger than 3 times 10 to the minus 26. And that's not an easy thing to get. So, conclusion.
To get rid of the symmetric component, sigma v needs to be larger than 3 times 10 to the minus 26 centimeters cubed per second,
which is not so easy with heavy mediators. For instance, if you take a heavy mediator, the case where the dark matter cannot annihilate into some light state in the sector, then the answer is that sigma v is roughly, so I'm drawing this diagram. There is a phi, there is chi, and then there is gf. So we assume there is some mediator that couples dark matter sector into the starboard motor sector, as is in the starboard motor sector, as an example. And then this would go like g chi squared, g phi, g f squared, and then there is 1 over a phi to the 4th, right? So it's going to be proportional to a chi squared. Just from dimensional analysis, it's going to be phi, and all the rest are not important. And then is 10 to the minus 26 centimeters cubed per second, if we assume that these couplings relatively large, not too large. And this is for a 10 GeV particle. And this goes and squared, this squared, and times 200 GeV over mediator. So in order to get this large cross section, we need a pretty light mediator that is typically excluded by collider bounds and so on. And therefore, it's not such a trivial exercise to annihilate away the symmetric component unless in the hidden sector there are light states that the dark matter can annihilate to. Okay? So it's a much easier exercise if you are trying to annihilate the dark matter away through the hidden sector rather than the visible sector. It's unfortunate because then it would mean, for instance, that you don't expect to see annihilation so of course I was going to make a comment about CMB. Of course today if the dark matter is really asymmetric, then we don't expect to see annihilations because there is no one of the components, chi of chi bar, and therefore they cannot annihilate away because there's only chi or only chi bar, and you need chi chi bar in order to annihilate. Okay, so regarding CMB, there is a bar, but it's actually interesting. So you remember that I told you, that there is a bound that I'll mention, but we won't discuss from CMB, because if dark matter annihilates sufficiently fast during the CMB era, it reionizes the universe, and if it reionizes, it has an imprint in the CMB, and therefore there's a bound on the rate of annihilation to standard model particles during CMB. Okay? Now, So there's if you want, an upper limit on the rate. Here it goes the other way around in asymmetric dark matter, because you want an even larger cross-section to make sure that the asymmetry that is left is sufficiently strong, maybe that you annihilated away enough of the chi bar particles such that you don't see any imprint in the CMB. So the bound works the other way around for asymmetric dark matter. You need a large, sufficiently large cross-section such that you don't see any annihilation by the time of the CMB. Okay? Is there any other way of seeing it? We can depend, that's starting to be a model dependent question. For instance, how does the Dharma couple to us, whether we can see direct detection or indirect detection, the abundance from neutron stars, if the dark matter is bosonic, because neutron stars can accumulate a lot of dark matter, which will then condense and turn them into black holes, and so on and so forth. So there are limits, and there are ways of looking for dark matter. It's going to be very, very hard to establish that what we imagine that we see dark matter, it will be hard to establish that this dark matter is asymmetric. And in principle, it could have happened. For instance, if we had seen some dark matter in direct detection we'll start discussing in a moment. If we had seen dark matter in direct detection, this could have implied that we should also see it in the sun, but if we don't see it in the sun, this would mean that it may not be annihilated, hence asymmetric. So it's not a proof, I'll mention it again later. It's not a proof, but there are ways to kind of maybe get convinced that this is the right answer, but it's going to be hard to establish it.
Questions?
If the symmetric component annihilates to the visible sector, doesn't that mess up the asymmetry of, barrier asymmetry?
No, now it's the annihilation goes through not CP violating interaction, it's Kai Kai Bar. It's a state which, Kai Kai Bar together don't have the asymmetry.
Okay.
So it doesn't, it's going to go annihilated to F and F bar, the same number of bar particles and anti particles. You're right, during the production, you could worry that there's going to be a washout. This is precisely why you need step two, where you decouple the two sectors. You decouple the operator, the transfer, or the asymmetry from one sector to the other, because then you could have gotten rid of the asymmetry. You need to freeze it out. The asymmetry must be frozen out, and you do that by decoupling the two sectors. What's left is the annihilation, and the annihilation are not sensitive to the asymmetry, they are sensitive to the symmetric component. They always produce the same number of barriers and anti-barriers on the left of the number of barriers.
This isn't a bad thing, because you don't observe the same number of barriers and anti-barriers.
Isn't that all, sorry?
Is that not a bad thing? We don't observe many anti-barriers.
A bound of a man, we don't misunderstand. It certainly is a bound. We have mechanisms to explain why we don't see the, why we see an AC. Why we measure eta v to be about 6 times eta minus 10. So maybe I think I misunderstood your question. About on what?
Well, the F and F bar which you produce would subsequently annihilate protons. Is that the idea?
Well, they would interact, sure. And it depends on which and what temperature we're talking about. It could interact strongly if we are talking about the QCD phase transition. The temperature is about the QCD scale. It depends, they can do many things, but they just evolve. This is another contribution, if you want, adds some additional energy to the visible sector, but nothing more than that. It doesn't touch the asymmetry itself. It doesn't affect the asymmetry itself, it just affects the symmetry. I'm feeling this one. Okay, so just as a quick summary, so I'm going to conclude here, I'm going to end this discussion of production. I haven't been conclusive at all. There are other ideas. One big idea that we haven't discussed fully is the idea of out of equilibrium decays. So non-thermal production of dark matter. And this leptogenesis scenario is an example of non-thermal production, but there are many others that often people talk about moduli in the supersymmetry, so they started telling you about those. And moduli in supersymmetry can decay and produce dark matter, and they decay non-thermally and produce. So there are many mechanisms that discuss non-thermal production of dark matter. I gave you one example, but there's a huge literature on the subject. So just the ones that we have seen, what can we say? Well, what do we care about? First, we care about the IF sensitivity. And we care about whether they are measurable. Whether we can measure them.
And the last thing is, of course, whether we have a miracle. Okay? And if we just draw the table, so you see freeze out is okay, freeze in and the asymmetric. So IR. Okay. All of these were IR sensitive. This depends on the physics for the, say, vital neutrinos as an example. So this is not necessarily IR sensitive, IR sensitive and UV insensitive. What about measurable? Detectable. So freeze out was kind of guaranteed to be detectable because the wind has to couple to us pretty strongly, right? So guaranteed is a strong, very strong word, but we have a high hope of actually measuring the wind if this is the answer, because we are guaranteed to have a strong coupling, relatively strong coupling to us. Freeze out and decay, it's a super wind, it can couple very, very quickly, you don't have to see. That's also the case for freezing, and the asymmetric we said is also going to be very hard, so it's not guaranteed that we'll be able to measure anything. And then what about the miracle? So, this is a miracle. This is why we've been working on it for so long. The other ones don't. There is no real miracle that tells us why the mass is the right mass and how we produce these models in a way that explains both the abundance and for completely other reasons. So that's a short summary of what we did, and we're going to shift gears now and move on to a different topic, which is the probes of dark matter, experimental probes of dark matter. So are there any questions? Okay, so basically, very broadly, we have four ways of detecting dark matter, non-gravitationally. Dark matter can annihilate with the standard model particles. This is indirect detection. So indirect detection of dark matter, this is my time axis. So dark matter can annihilate into standard model particles and antiparticles, photons and so on. That's indirect detection. We wrote this diagram. That's direct detection. Dark matter collides with our detector, some standard model particle, and leaves some energetic imprint, which is what we look for. This is direct detection. Then we can try to produce it, so we rotate this diagram again, and we try to produce dark matter. And this is collider, this is what we do, collider. Direct production of dark matter by colliding some standard model particles. And finally, we have what we call astrophysical probes, where we just have dark matter interacting with itself, and that may change some properties of astrophysical objects that we look at.
So this looks extremely optimistic. We have so many ways of looking for dark matter. We should have seen it already. So now let's go one by one. And today, a lot of, I guess, some of tomorrow, we're going to spend a lot of time discussing, some time discussing direct detection. And then we'll go to the other. Okay, so the direct detection is up. So I'll mention in a second, but we roughly know, we roughly think, we don't know, we roughly think the local density of dark matter around us is on the order of 0.3 to 0.4 GeV per centimeter cubed. This is wrong by an order of magnitude. This I won't work for the chair, but that's the right, that's the value that people are talking about these days. We also know that the velocity is roughly 0.93 the velocity of the speed of light compared to the speed of light. So there is just a flux of dark matter. So this is the velocity relative to us. So there's a flux of dark matter, right? It's just the end of dark matter times its velocity, which controls some over the dark matter mass. That's the number density times the velocity. That gives us whatever, 10 to the 7, right? 10 to the 7 centimeters to the minus, 10 to the minus 7. Sorry. Centimeters to the minus 2, seconds to the minus 1. Did I get it wrong? Yeah. Right? And so this is roughly, and that's for and here, like, what do I end? So we have a huge flux of particles. We think we have a huge flux of particles that go through us all the time. And the whole idea of direct detection is that we take a tank of material, we put it deep underground, and we discuss why deep underground, but we put it deep underground, and we wait. Because these particles go through us all the time, once in a while, maybe they interact, because they do have this kind of interaction. And if they do have this kind of interaction, they kick one of the atoms. So we put a ton of material. So I've got a number of times a ton. And we hope that this dark matter will interact with one of these particles out of the 10 to the 27 or so particles in our tank. It will kick it a little bit, it will leave a small imprint of energy, and that's what we're trying to detect. And there are tens of experiments like that, they put it deep underground, and they wait for years. And what I want to describe now is to go through what are the inputs, what are we assuming, and what goes into these calculations of limits that come out of these experiments. Okay? Now this sounds, the fact that you have all these particles going through you all the time is, you should already be used to, because neutrinos do exactly the same, right? Neutrinos are produced in the sun and in the atmosphere all the time. They go through us all the time, and we just don't feel it because they interact too weakly. Okay, so what do we need? What are the inputs that we need in order to calculate the delay detection rate. So we are after the rate of interruption of dark matter with our detection. Okay? So the inputs. So what does the scattering rate wind of dark matter. So this is this flux that I was talking about of dark matter. Okay? So we need to know two things. We need to know what is the velocity and how does it, is it distributed, and of course what is the density. Okay, so how do we do that? Well, here comes a big uncertainty. The way we do that, we need to understand how much dark matter there is in our galaxy, and the only way to know how to do that is by doing some n-body simulations. So we want to know how is dark matter, how much dark matter there is, and how is it distributed in phase space. So the n-body simulations, and these n-body simulations take, say, a billion particles, and they let them run and form galaxies, and they assume they don't interact. So this is the case where these simulations just take dark matter, but they don't consider variables. And the output of that is some velocity distribution. And some density distribution.
Sandy, can you comment about the fact that you don't consider the variance?
I'm sorry, yeah. So, absolutely. So, variance are much harder to take into account, of course. There are experiments that are n-body simulations that are starting to take the resolution is worse. And there are many uncertainties that people still have to deal with when discussing the effect of baryons inside these galaxies. Okay, so it's not, people are well aware of it, and it's a highly developed and rapidly moving field of research, but it's still unclear what is the right density and what are the uncertainties of a given, when I want to find out what is the density of dark matter in my galaxy and its velocity distribution, as we take into account the variables in the set. Okay. And what I'm telling you, the usual kind of... there are large uncertainties. And I'll give you some answers that people use. Okay. So, bottom line, you want to know what do people do, but you have to remember that we have large uncertainties here. The large uncertainties are actually coming especially in tails of distribution. And the tails of distributions are very important because they describe the energetic dark matter that we may actually see. So we talk about the fact that we need to see dark matter for dark matter in order to leave an imprint, it has to have some minimal velocity. And this minimal velocity depends on the distribution. So we are strongly depending on the tails of distribution which we don't fully understand. So there are large uncertainties and you just keep it in mind. These are not unrelated, these are related by Eugene's theory. Namely, the density and the velocities are related. And now let me just tell you what are the answers, what are the solutions that people use. Okay, so there are many n-body simulations, GEALO and the Galactea and all kinds of simulations. There are many groups, and like I said, it's 90 feet. I'm not at all going to talk about it, but just give you some results. Okay. So density distribution. Okay, let me write the density distribution tomorrow. So what people often take is the following. So this is one answer that people use. Our distance. This is our distance from the galactic center. 10.5 kiloparsec. This is the density around us, which we believe to be 0.3 to 0.4 GeV per centimeter squared. And now we have all kinds of values for alpha, beta, and gamma. So there's for example, the NFW profile. Then just takes alpha equals gamma equals 1, and beta equals 3, and the RAS is just a little parsec. And so, rho of R is sum of R times RAS plus R times. Okay, so the density diverges, it becomes very cuspy close to the exact same. We enter the inner part of the galaxy, and this is will be also very important when we talk about indirect detection, because when we look at for indirect detection, we want to see dark matter that annihilating close to the galactic center. Often we want to see dark matter annihilating close to the galactic center. For that, we need to know how much dark matter there is there. And there are large uncertainties of how is the density, what is the density of dark matter close to the center. Another limit is the isothermal. There is some observational and our A is 30 kilometers per second. 30 kiloparsec. And so rho here is not cuspy at all. It doesn't diverge as we put down close to the center. Okay. So if you want, this often is used to kind of the difference between the often used to kind of illustrate the implication of the uncertainty. Okay. There's another profile that people use, which is not of this form, it's called the Ignazio profile.
Why they start differing at R sum?
Why are they all the same? Because yeah, that's what we measure. They are normalized such that in our region we see what we measure. So we claim to measure the density of dark matter around us.
But how do you know?
I'll talk about it. I'll say very, very roughly, we'll talk about the back movement, but in principle, we do. We could look for rotation theory, we could look for the effect of how much, you know, of how stars move close to us and away from us as we go up in the galactic plane. The really difficult part is to disentangle the effect of the galactic plane with the dark matter versus the rest of the dark matter, which is away from the galactic plane. So there's a difficulty there in the measurements and the assumption itself. The idea is we look at the rotations and we measure, we estimate the density. But it's not as if it's not as if everyone agrees that all sun is 1.3. You and all of the papers claim that it's at least an order of magnitude or two away, smaller. And then there were other papers that claim to be done so. I think they did that well. I think now it's established that you guys. But it's not a big, like I said, not for future. Okay.